Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the sixth meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2022, which we are conducting in hybrid format this week, with some members present in the room and others attending remotely. At agenda item one, we have consideration of whether to take agenda item five in private. Item five is consideration of the committee's work programme. Do we agree to take that in private? That is agreed. Item 5 will be taken in private. Agenda 2 is consideration of evidence on the Workplace Parking Licensing Scotland Regulations 2022. These regulations are subject to the negative procedure. This means that they will become law unless within 40 days a motion to annul has been laid. We had a short evidence session on the regulations with the Minister of Transport and officials on the 8th of February. On the 9th of February, a motion to annul this instrument was lodged by Graeme Simpson, MSP, who is joining us this morning. Before we have the formal debate on the motion, I thought it would be helpful to have a second and final evidence session with the Minister and officials in relation to this instrument. This will give us further opportunity to ask questions and seek clarification in relation to the instrument. I therefore welcome Jenny Gilruth, MSP, Minister for Transport, who is joining us remotely. I also welcome officials who are joining us remotely, Heather Cowan, Elizabeth Hawley and Elise McIntyre. Thank you all for joining the committee today. I put on record the committee's thanks to the organisations who provided submissions to inform this session. Please note that some of those submissions were sent to the committee after publication of the meeting papers, and we will be publishing those submissions later this week. I would now like to invite the Minister to make some brief opening remarks, which will be followed by questions from members. So, Minister, over to you, please.
Convener, thank you for the opportunity to make another opening statement today to provide further evidence in support of the Workplace Parking Licensing Scotland Regulations 2022 and to debate the motion to annul this SSI made by Graeme Simpson. As previously outlined during my evidence to the committee just 2 weeks ago, the power for local authorities to implement workplace parking licensing schemes was provided by Parliament under the 2019 Transport Act, following an extensive evidence session by the predecessor committee to this one, and further regulations and guidance are now necessary in order for local authorities to implement these schemes. The Act itself reflects that the power rests with local authorities to design schemes based on local circumstances, including on setting the licensing charge. The Act also reflects the key themes of accountability and transparency. It specifies what a local authority must set out as part of any proposed workplace parking levy scheme, and that includes the licence charge payable, which is also specified per workplace parking space per annum. It places robust requirements on local authorities to set out the scheme proposal, including the licence charge, and to carry out consultation and impact assessment before making any scheme. The Act also includes provisions for either the local authority or Scottish ministers to initiate an independent examination of a proposed scheme if they choose to consider it appropriate. Workplace parking licensing schemes have the potential to encourage the use of more sustainable travel while raising revenue that will be also used to improve public transport and sustainable transport too. It also supports our commitment to reduce car kilometres travelled by 20% by 2030 as part of our climate change goals, as supported by all parties at the time of the Climate Change Act. Councils in England and Wales have had these powers for over a decade, during which time Conservative government has been content to retain the power for councils in England to bring forward these types of schemes. And we've seen how workplace parking licensing can support climate change goals in Nottingham, which I discussed, I think, 2 weeks ago, which is amongst the highest public transport use in the country, with an associated fall of 40 million car miles over the last 15 years. Other English cities, including Leicester and Oxford, are also developing their own local schemes. So firstly, Mr Simpson's motion today is attempting to deny Scottish councils the same powers that are provided by his Westminster colleagues to English councils. Secondly, it is at odds with his previous statement that, and I quote, "We believe that decisions should be taken as locally as possible and that power should lie with politicians elected as locally as possible." But thirdly, nothing in the regulations before committee today has any impact on the level of licensing charge, an issue which was raised, I know, last week during the previous evidence session, 2 weeks ago rather. The decision to put that in the hands of local authorities following local consultation and assessment of impact was made by Parliament in 2019 in primary legislation and it can't be changed by the regulations today. So the motion to annul today is misplaced, inconsistent, and it is at odds with policy which has been already agreed by Parliament some 3 years ago now. Now, if councils choose to develop their own workplace parking licensing schemes as part of their transport strategies to reduce congestion, air pollution and invest in sustainable transport, then that's a choice for which they are accountable, not me as a minister and not the Scottish Government. I'd urge the committee today to give them the appropriate regulatory tools to support that decision. My officials and I are happy to answer any further questions the committee may have on the regulations today. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. We will now move to questions. And let me start with a procedural question for you. If the motion to annul were to be passed by the committee today, would that simply mean that you could take the draft instrument away, reflect on the important concerns raised by stakeholders such as the Chamber of Commerce, CBI, SRC and the Food and Drink Federation, address the defects they think are inherent in the instrument, and then bring it back at a later date, improved and corrected?
Thank you for the question, Convener. I am going to default to officials on this. I don't think that if we took the motion to annul, so if it passed today and what you suggested was looked at again, I think the primary legislation is still on the statute books and it could only be overridden by another form of primary legislation. So I'll pass to officials to clarify on that technical point, though.
Minister, yeah, it's Heather Cowan here. To confirm what Ms Garuth has set out, the regulation that's before committee today provides the framework for local authorities to implement workplace parking levy licensing schemes, but there is nothing in that regulation pertaining to the motion to annul and the points raised by this committee. It would have to go back to primary legislation. So the absence of the regulation today would still provide committees with local authorities with the power to implement workplace parking levy schemes. It just wouldn't have the additional framework in terms of the transparency consultation requirements on local authorities that are in the regulation before committee today. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for that response. I think we'll come back to that later in the questions, because I think there's some further clarification required in relation to that response. But before we do that, let me bring in Fiona Hislop.
Thank you very much and good morning. It is helpful if the Minister could clarify the difference between what the Act contains, which was passed by the Scottish Parliament some years ago, and the SSI that's before us. Clearly, if there are defects in the instrument, that would have been alerted to us. I think the main concern seems to be on timing issues, but it would be helpful if the Minister could identify if anything has been brought to the Government's attention in terms of any actual technical aspects of it. So the instrument in front of us today is primarily about the mechanism, and indeed specifying quite a lot of safeguards for communities in terms of the consultation process, the setting out of the charges, and also the point about a reporter, which you mentioned, so you can maybe expand on that a bit. And I think it's also important to, if you can give any indication as to whether it's every single local authority in Scotland that we expect to be using this, or any indication of, is it just the two major cities, as it has previously back in 2017 been the case from their own manifestos from different parties in those two cities. And then finally, on consultation, clearly I'm very familiar with my constituency lying between Glasgow and Edinburgh of commuters travelling to Glasgow and Edinburgh. And clearly now we have city region deals which have transport aspects to it, particularly for commuters, including park and ride, particularly from the outskirts of Edinburgh into Edinburgh. Surely any consultations, for example, by the City of Edinburgh should consider the impact on middle Lothian, East Lothian, West Lothian, but clearly the spend might be best placed in park and ride for bus lanes into those cities, because obviously clearly Edinburgh's got a very good transport system that could always be improved. And similarly, going into Glasgow, I'm campaigning for a park and ride from Whitburn into both cities as well. So they're the type of things that people are looking for, but perhaps in expanding your thoughts, your understanding, if you can touch on some of those matters, and I'm quite happy for you to bring in some of the officials in differentiating between what's in the Act and what's in the SSI. Always open for people to bring back SSIs, but I think the key issue seems to be about timing, unless something else has been brought to your attention.
Thank you. Convener, to come to, there's quite a lot to unpack there, Mrs. Lopes' line of questioning. So, first of all, the legislation passed in 2019, and I discussed this in my response to you. I might bring some of the officials in on the specifics of the SSI, but my understanding is the SSI will give local authorities the power to enact the legislation. But it's also worth pointing out in terms of timing that this isn't going to happen overnight. I think Glasgow suggested it could take up to 3 years to enact a scheme, so it's not going to happen quickly. And to speak to some of the criticisms around about where business is at this moment in time, I think that provides a level of safeguarding because we don't know where we're going to be in 3 years' time. But in terms of the recovery, it's important that we have a sustainable recovery and one which also takes cognizance of our climate change obligations. We mustn't shy away from that in response to recovering from the pandemic. Now, Ms. Islop asked a number of questions, a line of questioning around about the role of the reporter, I think. And I think the Act does set out that either the local authority proposing the workplace parking scheme or Scottish ministers may appoint a reporter to conduct an examination into the scheme proposal. It's not my view that it would be routine for ministers to do that, given that it might delay schemes unnecessarily. And of course, a local authority wouldn't be able to proceed until examination of any scheme would be complete, so it would slow the process down. But it is important nonetheless to say that ministers can initiate an examination by appointing a reporter. So, for example, if there was a concern. Now, obviously, last week, 2 weeks ago rather, apologies, we had a conversation around about the level of charging being set. So, for example, if there was a feeling in the local community that the level of charge was felt to be too high, that could be addressed by the reporter in the examination of the scheme. And I think it's important to say that safeguard has been built into how it will operate. The regulations also set out a process for the examination to be conducted, and those they're really essentially heavily based around the regulations governing the examination process for LEZ. And we also would anticipate the reporter to be sourced from the Department of Planning and Environmental Appeals. I think I mentioned that, if not in my letter, then in evidence to the committee 2 weeks ago now. I'm trying to make sure, Convener, that I cover every point that Ms. Hislop raised. On consultation, you raised an important point. This is absolutely essential to the local requirements for local authorities to be responsible and accountable for these schemes. There is an obligation and responsibility for local authorities to consult with their local community on how their scheme would operate. So, to the example she gave, I think, around park and ride schemes and also the impact of city-region deals, I think that absolutely requires local authorities to look up and to look out at the way in which their scheme would impact on different local authority areas, but equally to tie their local transport strategy plans to what they want to get out of the scheme itself. Because fundamentally, the workplace parking scheme gives local authorities additional revenue to invest in their own local transport strategy. And that's hugely important. It empowers local authorities. And I hope that the committee will vote to support the regulations today. But I appreciate, Convener, we'll have a debate about that in the minutes yet to come.
Thank you.
I don't know if officials want to come in on the specifics. Apologies on the technical detail.
Is there any official wanting to come in on that? Can't tell.
I think my colleague Elizabeth Hawley was going to come in, but she's not off mute yet.
Okay.
Thank you. Happy to come in on some of the question about what's in the Act versus what's in the SSI. So kind of going back to what the Minister said, and I'll just run through very quickly the sort of key elements that are in the SSI. The Act sets out a robust requirement for local authorities proposing schemes to consult people who are likely to be impacted by the scheme. And then the SSI places sort of further detail in the framework of that, for example, setting out where the consultation has to be published and how people can respond to the consultation. So it's very much a level of technical detail to ensure that transparency and to ensure that the intention of the Act in terms of that consultation is carried out. Moving on to examination, again, the Act sets out that there is an option for ministers or the local authority to initiate that examination, and the regulations set out the exact process by which that examination would be initiated, how the reporter who was conducting that examination would consider the representations that had been made and make the decision on how to conduct that examination. And then liability for charge, the Act sets out that the liability sits with the employer who's providing parking on net premises, and then the regulations expand out on that in situations where, for example, several employers are sharing one car park, and that was actually discussed by the predecessor committee to this one in 2019 at stage two of the consideration of the Transport Bill. The SSI also sets out that there is a process for appealing licensing decisions and that there's an appeals to the Sheriff. Again, the Act sets out that there should be an appeals process, but the SSI actually sets out how that appeals process is conducted by summary application to the Sheriff. The Act sets out that there will be enforcement by way of penalty charge. The regulation sets out exactly what has to be in that penalty charge notice and how those are issued, some of the time, you know, constraints to make sure, again, that that process is fair, and again, a route of appeal, to the first tribunal and then on to the upper tribunal if appropriate. And then finally, the Act sets out that any revenue from the WPL scheme after operational costs must be spent in support of the objectives set out in the local transport strategy. The SSI sort of supports that by placing accounting requirements on local authorities to make sure that those accounts are published in a transparent and fair way. So I hope that sort of answers the questions. I think I'd also note that having reviewed the submissions to the committee that were published with committee papers, the concerns are primarily on decisions that were in the Act. Like, we didn't see any concerns on the actual instrument, I think, before the committee today. Thank you.
Thank you. That's very comprehensive in the history and the context, and indeed that the issue is not necessarily the SSI with some people, it's actually with the original Act, which was passed some time ago. But that was quite comprehensive, so I'm quite happy now to pass back over to the convener.
OK, thanks very much, Fiona. Liam Kerr to be followed by Jack Aitkenbar.
Thank you, convener. I'll just fire very quick questions, if I may, Minister. First of all, what does the modelling show is the minimum level of charge which will drive the behaviour change which you want onto public transport?
Well, I think I have answered this question, convener, in my response to the committee. So if I can just direct Mr Kerr to that letter around about modelling. As the letter states on the issue of behaviour change based on whether employers choose to pass on the charge to employees, we looked at Nottingham City Council in terms of the modelling of behaviour change. And I think they also previously made a submission to the Historic REC Committee as part of that committee's evidence gathering at the time of the Stage 2 amendments. So I think in its evidence, Nottingham Council showed that the supply of liable workplace parking places decreased by 17.5% prior to licensing being introduced, as employers sought to limit their liability with a more gradual reduction in the number of workplace parking places provided by employers since its introduction. And Nottingham City Council also gave evidence showing a number of major employers moved into or consolidated to city centre locations with good public transport accessibility. I think to the broader point around about Mr Kerr's question, because I appreciate he asked this 2 weeks ago now, quite difficult to model a scheme which hasn't yet been in existence. We don't yet have one of these schemes in existence in Scotland. So the best way in which I think we can learn as a government, or local authorities rather can learn, is from modelling what's happened in Nottingham City Council. And I think the content of the letter covers some of the specifics to Mr Kerr's questions. I also note, though, that in one of the submissions the committee has received, I think ahead of today, I think it was from Transform Scotland, there are some statistics around about the need for traffic demand management. Now, I don't know if that goes to explain or perhaps give a bit more context to the rationale behind the policy itself and the increase in terms of the costs associated with public transport in comparison to driving, and the need therefore to encourage that behaviour change. I don't know if officials want to see more on the specifics of modelling. Again, I think Mr Kerr will appreciate, sorry, I can see him jacking, but I can't hear what he's saying. I think Mr Kerr will appreciate, I wasn't here when the legislation, the 2019 Act, was debated. So I may want to bring in officials on the modelling point again, but it was addressed in my letter to the committee just weeks ago.
Well, perhaps, so thank you for that full answer. I'm just looking for a figure. What is the figure, the minimum level of charge, which will drive the behaviour change? So perhaps if that is in the letter, she can, the Minister can give me that as we move on. The second question, Transport Scotland, in this final business and regulatory impact assessment, Transport Scotland said the Scottish Government needs to produce guidance and regulations to ensure national consistency and the success of this scheme. Has that guidance been produced, Minister?
Nope. The guidance, so to your specific point, the guidance has not yet been produced. It will be produced when this SSI has been passed, hopefully, by this committee. So it's dependent on this being passed by committee today, specifically on that. On the figure itself, though, there is no figure identified at this moment in time. It is absolutely for local authorities to carry out that modelling and to look at really essentially their own local circumstances. It's not for me to direct them. This is a power for local authorities to use, and it's dependent on their own local circumstances.
Although Transport Scotland, of course, would like ministerial direction, of course, as I've just read out in my question. Minister, there's something I genuinely, I don't understand this, and I just wonder if you can help me with this. Businesses already pay tax on parking spaces, I believe, through the business rate scheme. Has the government taken advice as to whether it would be legally competent to double tax the same piece of property under two separate taxes?
Double tax? I think Mr Kerr's point here doesn't refer to the regulations. I think it refers to the legislation itself. So can I ask an official to pick up the specifics on his point around about double taxing of, or perceived double taxing of businesses in that respect?
Minister, I'm happy to come in and say that that would be part of local authorities' impact assessment requirements under the Act. So they're required to take into account the impact on those that would be affected, which would include taking into account the impact on businesses within the scheme parameters that they've set out.
I have no further questions at this stage, Convener.
OK. Just to clarify that second point, the impact assessment is a slightly different response to the question from Mr Kerr, which was about whether the Scottish Government has sought legal advice on the potential impact of double taxation. So it's not so much a consultation or impact assessment, it's a question on whether the Scottish Government sought legal advice on this particular issue.
I don't know if officials would like to come in on this specific point.
Aware of any issues with regard to that. The Act passed Parliament and the SI has been before the Legislative Committee, and there were no issues raised at the DPRC Committee with regards to the SI and its drafting.
Okay, thank you very much. Let me call Jackie Dunbar to be followed by Monica Lennon.
Thank you and good morning, Minister. If you don't mind, I would like to ask a few questions around the process of exemptions. We've had responses from people in regard to their businesses about how they feel that they would they should be exempt from this. Can I ask you, Minister, just for clarification and maybe some explanation as well, and give examples of what the exemptions could be, who would be responsible to lay out these exemptions, and also what the process of putting the exemptions in place would be.
Specifically, as we've discussed, the workplace parking levy is a discretionary power for local authorities, so it will be for the local council to decide whether they wish to use that power and the shape of the proposals that they will judge to be appropriate for their local circumstances. They will need to decide whether or not they wish to implement locally their own WPL, and they will also require to undertake a public consultation, which I think we touched upon in response to another member's question this morning. And that public consultation will also require to look at an impact assessment before implementing any scheme, which is hugely important. Local authorities also may use their revenues, of course, which will be generated from the levy itself to support policies in their local transport strategy. But to the specifics of Ms Dunbar's question around about exemptions, the only national exemptions that exist in the regulations at this moment in time are the blue badge holders for healthcare workers at NHS premises and parking places at hospices. There are three different types of exemptions that exist at national level. Any other consideration around about exemptions would be for a local authority to look at and to consider, subject to their local environment, which I think is really important in terms of empowering local authorities to take decisions which best meet and suit their local area. And we know, for example, and we discussed this in some detail 2 weeks ago now, that people on lower incomes are less likely to travel by car, and any revenue, of course, raised by the fund itself will be used to support local transport strategies, which I touched upon. But that too can support greener transport choices and more affordable public transport than that low-income households often rely on. So that's hugely important point. When we talk about exemptions for healthcare workers, for example, and parking places at hospices, this is not to curtail local authorities from looking wider. They will be able to exempt any groups or premises based on their individual local circumstances. And I think that's really important. It's also a decision for local authorities and the timing of the scheme itself, as I touched upon. And I know that Edinburgh City's mobility plan sets out the income from the workplace parking levy is going to be used to deliver public transport improvements by 2025. But these schemes are not going to happen overnight. But it absolutely is really important that local authorities have the responsibility and the choice in how they take forward any relevant exemptions for their local communities that they serve.
Okay, thank you very much for your answer. Back to you, convener.
Thank you very much, Jackie. Let me bring in Monica Lennon to be followed by Mark Ruskell. Monica, please.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, Minister, and your officials. Minister, I think we all recognise that you were only appointed to your posts last month, and it must be very challenging to take on a brand new brief. So I think we all want to cheer you on in that regard, because the issues that you're grappling with are so important. But it is apparent to me and possibly others that in terms of some of the questions that we've asked you last week and this week, and I've read your letter to the committee, you are struggling to give us some basic answers and are relying on your officials, who I appreciate are working hard behind the scenes. So it feels that we're at a point in time where it's really, really important that this is right in terms of where we are right now. We have a cost of living crisis. We have a public in Scotland who absolutely get that we have a climate emergency, but they want to be taken on a journey that is fair and that is just. So can I ask what discussions you have had in your new position with the STUC, because they represent over 500,000 workers in Scotland, and they're saying in the last week or so that Scotland's public transport is not up to scratch. They're very concerned about the cost of living crisis, and that this workplace parking levy will penalise workers. These are genuine concerns by trade unions who want climate action to happen, who want better public transport. What discussions have you had directly with the STUC about their concerns, and what reassurance can you give workers today that this is not going to push them further into poverty and this deep cost of living crisis?
I thank Ms Lennon for her question and her sympathy in some of the intonation. Nonetheless, we are talking about regulations here. We're not talking about the legislation which happened back in 2019. Now, I will bring in officials around about what consultation was carried out with unions back in 2019, but I have to say in the last 2 weeks, I've had no conversations with the STUC on the specific regulations. I have met with the unions on a number of other issues, which she may understand, but not on the specifics of these regulations. I would imagine, however, and I will wait for officials to confirm, that my predecessor would have met with the unions absolutely on these points. I think she makes a really relevant points around about cost of living and also on public transport. It's important to remember, though, that the liability for the charge itself, the workplace parking levy, sits with employers, not with employees. And it's a matter for employers whether or not they pass that cost on to employees. So it's not a tax on workers per se. Now, we've spoken this morning around about local authorities' responsibilities to design schemes that suit their own local circumstances. And as Ms Lennon highlighted, we know that those in lower income households are less likely to have access to a private car, and also those living in more deprived areas are disproportionately affected by the negative impacts of car use, including from pollution and road danger. So our aim absolutely is to move away from the status quo of car dominance that already negatively impacts those on lower incomes. And supporting that just transition has to be really key to our route map to reducing car kilometres in Scotland by 20% by 2030. And that includes other interventions to ensure a just transition. Now, Ms Lennon spoke around some of the challenges on public transport. So one of the things we're looking at in government at the moment, as she may be aware of, is a fair fares review, which I think is really, really important. It looks at joining up journeys on different modes of public transport. We've also introduced, as she may be aware, I think 3 weeks ago now, the free bus travel for under 22s. Again, a hugely important policy, welcomed, I think, by the trade unions. and the national rollout programme of free cycles for those who can't afford them additionally. Now, I mentioned around about the exemptions previously, but I hope that gives Ms Lennon some reassurance around about the importance of protecting poorer workers from what kind of some of the challenges she spoke to. On the specifics, so she did raise a question around about the SUC. Now, I've given her my answer on that, but I may bring officials in who may have dates and details of when previous ministers met with the SUC on this per se.
Deputy Minister, because I was asking about the discussions that you have had with the SUC in the last month or so, because I think, as other colleagues have hinted at, it's important that we get this right and we have an opportunity to take a beat, to pause and to make sure that we're getting this right, because this is a workplace parking levy. It will directly affect workers. You're trying to change the behaviour of workers. So the fact that you haven't discussed it with the STUC is a point of concern to me. I know from other work that you're doing, which I do welcome, you are trying to look at making public transport safer for women in particular. So what is your, you know, what is your message today to women who don't feel safe using buses, who don't feel safe using trains, or can't get on a bus or train? For example, where I live in Hamilton, the X1 bus, which is the express service to Glasgow, which people felt really safe using, that's gone. I did speak to your predecessor about that. The bus hasn't been brought back by anyone, by First Bus, by SPT, by South Lancashire Council, by the Scottish Government. So, you know, people in my area might be able to swallow a workplace parking levy if they had a bus that they could get on. So these are, you know, we've all got examples, Minister. What is your message to people who are worried that they don't feel safe, there isn't a bus to get on, and they're going to have to take the car anyway and possibly bear the cost of this because their employer may well pass it on, which is experience in 8 out of 10 cases, I believe, in Nottingham, that example that you're so keen on. So people are worried, Minister. What is your response? They don't want to know about the difference between the legislation, the regulations. They want to know, you are the brand new Transport Minister. What are you doing to listen to people's genuinely held concerns?
I thank Ms Lennon for her supplementary question. I think so. She raises a number of points. I'll try to unpack all of them. There's quite a lot here, convener. Just to go back to her original point around about impact assessments, I think she mentioned, this is really a power for local authorities to make local decisions dependent on their area. It's not for me to direct. It's not for me to interrupt. This is about local accountability, and I think that's really important. I think Ms Lennon was a councillor prior to her election to the Parliament. I think it's important we empower our local authorities, we give them greater opportunities to raise revenue so that they can better take cognizance of their local population and invest in public transport in their local area. So she raises, for example, the issue around about women's safety. So there's a broader challenge here, I think, which is not actually specific to this SSI. I did discuss it in the chamber in the statement on operator of last resort, which would have been the last week of term, and our plans to consult with women and women's organisations about their safety on public transport. I think that's hugely important. It's not just about trains, it's not just about buses, it's about the places that women are waiting for when they're going to get on public transport. It's about their journeys to public transport, but a much broader conversation we need to have about women's safety. But I don't want to narrowly siphon it off to this SSI. I'm not necessarily sure that this SSI is the place in which to have the conversation. This SSI is the detail which gives local authorities the power to enact the legislation that was passed 3 years ago. It is historic legislation. And the reason it's not been taken forward before now is because of COVID. The pandemic slowed many things down in government, as Ms Lennon will understand. And therefore, we're now passing the SSI, which will empower local authorities to take this forward. He mentioned a concern around about the SUC. I have met with all the rail unions, and I have to say to her, and on broader issues we discussed too, this was not raised with me. I spent a long time actually on the last Thursday of term, in fact, nearly 3 hours actually with the unions, specifically talking about rail, but also about some of the wider challenges on women's safety. The workplace parking levy was not raised with me. So I want to give her that reassurance and understanding that, one, I have actually made quite a lot of time to meet with the unions, and two, it's not been raised with me. But on the third wider point, and I did say I would ask officials on this, it's around about whether or not, you know, how ministers previously engaged with unions on this. I think that's a fair enough point. I may bring in Heather on that specifically. I suspect it's historical to the 2019 legislation, but happy to be corrected on that point.
Yes, thank you, Minister. I'm happy to come in and confirm that ministers also met with rail unions regularly during 2019 and during the Act, and at that point would have engaged with the unions according to the agenda set. And so if WPL was on the agenda, then it would have been engaged with the STUC. There was also exchange of ministerial letters, so STUC and other unions wrote to ministers and ministers responded. And then there was also, of course, the predecessor committee's evidence session at stage two on WPL, which enabled unions and other stakeholders to offer evidence and perspectives on WPL. And I think in general, as we've set out, that a lot of the stakeholder comment has either been on the Act and so was therefore heard and considered as part of the evidence and the process of passage of the bill through the committee and through Parliament at stage three, or are on the specific individual schemes of local authorities. And so therefore dependent, for example, on the geography set by local authorities for WPL. And so actually there's no specific scheme details on which to engage unions or other stakeholders on, because that will be the responsibility of a local authority as part of setting out the scheme and undertaking that consultation and impact assessment. Thank you.
Back to you, convener.
Okay, Monica, thank you very much. Let me bring in Mark Ruskell to be followed by Natalie Dawn. Let me just say we've got a lot of ground to cover, so can we have brief questions and answers, please? Mark, over to you.
I'll do my best, convener. I mean, I appreciate we're going back to a lot of the more fundamental arguments around this scheme that were already debated back in 2019. But can I ask you, Minister, about the funding and where this funding will go? Will it be in addition to the funding that councils have already allocated for public transport schemes to make people's journeys to work easier? Because there will be some people looking at this thinking, well, I'm going to have to potentially pay more money to get to work. How will my travel to work actually be easier as a result of this? Can I actually see concrete additional benefits, acceleration of existing programmes and schemes that councils are considering, or maybe even bringing in new initiatives like park and rides or better public transport facilities to make it actually easier for people, rather than people just feeling that, well, this is just another tax, another thing I'm going to have to pay out?
Yeah. So I think Mark Ruskell might have raised this point, convener, in the last session, but just to confirm, yes, this is additional funding for local authorities. The funds that they raise from the workplace parking levy will be used to implement their own local transport strategies. So he talked around about some examples there. I think in the last conversation that we had, maybe 2 weeks ago now, I cited some examples of what have been done in Nottingham. So the Nottingham scheme is, I think, less than £2 a day. The city has generated around £75 million of new revenue since the scheme started back in 2012, supporting the expansion, of course, of Nottingham's successful tram system and the redevelopment and enhancement of Nottingham Station, which, again, I think I mentioned 2 weeks ago now. I think that point is really important, though, that any money raised is going back into the local area. So if people are contributing to the scheme, it's being spent locally on improving public transport or transport priorities for the local authority. So fundamentally, the local authority is accountable to its local population, but equally, people are paying into a scheme which will allow for greater development and enhancement, arguably, of the local transport infrastructure.
Okay. Okay, thanks for that further reassurance. The other point I wanted to raise was in your letter to the committee, and you made the point that what we might see is employers starting to shift away from out-of-town locations back into city centres again. Mm-hmm. Now, clearly our city centres have been gutted because of COVID and economic downturn. That's affecting small businesses as well. Is there evidence for that? Are there promising signs from Nottingham or other places that we might see a revitalisation of our town centres, which would benefit everybody, particularly small businesses, as a result of a workplace parking levy? Would it add another lever to encourage that regeneration of our high streets, which we're really desperately needing at the moment?
Absolutely. I think it's really important we do encourage that regeneration of our high streets. We know the pandemic has had a huge impact on high streets, which even prior to the pandemic had arguably been decimated by the increase in online shopping, for example. So it's hugely important that these schemes help to drive that inward investment. And I think, too, to some of Mr. Ruskell's points around about challenges for smaller businesses, there is an opportunity for local authorities to introduce their own exemptions, which I think I mentioned in my response to Jackie Dunbar. So, for example, the Nottingham example, businesses in Nottingham with 10 or fewer parking places, they've exempted. So smaller businesses are not hit, I suppose, to the same extent because they have less employees. And I think that's important to take recognition of that, because in Scotland we have a larger number of SMEs than other parts of the UK. But it's absolutely essential to driving the revitalisation of our high streets and to encouraging people to, you know, walk to work, to cycle to work if they're able to do so safely. And these are broader plans that we have in government to drive that sustainable recovery, to allow our high streets to recover, but also to encourage that modal shift. We have to get folk out of their cars. And I know, and I think I referenced this in my response to Mr Kerr, there's some quite good stats on the Transport Scotland briefing, which looks at the cost of driving in comparison to public transport over the cost of the last 10 years, for example. And the gap for those from poorer backgrounds, for example, being most adversely affected by that widening impact in the cost of living, for example, and average wages, but also looking at the cost of public transport itself. Now, we in government have a challenge here, and I spoke, I think, to Ms Lennon on how we might be able to do that through the Fair Fares Review, which I think is hugely important. But equally, if driving is becoming much more affordable and we need to get folk out of their cars, I mean, I think I'm perfectly prepared to be correct on this, but transport accounts for 40% of all emissions in Scotland. We're the largest kind of polluter, as it were, in terms of a part of government. We need to take direct action on this. And this is one way in which government can empower local authorities to do that, but also to raise revenue, to invest locally in their own transport priorities, but equally, as Mr Ruskell has noted, to drive that revitalisation and regeneration of Scotland's high streets.
OK, thanks. Back to you, convener.
Thank you very much, Mark. Natalie Dawn, please.
Thanks, convener. Thanks for your comments so far, Minister. So, from what I've heard today, in order for local authorities to carry this out in the best way possible, these regulations should be passed. For me, this is essentially about, we've talked a lot about this already, empowering local authorities to carry out and create a system that best works for their communities. So, I mean, in terms of that, the empowerment is with local authorities. Does the Minister agree that this is a wholly positive move? And can you elaborate more on the COSLA position? Because I understand that COSLA are broadly supportive of this. And given that we're talking about local authorities and empowering local authorities, there hasn't been much discussion this morning on what they actually think. Are you able to provide any information on support and principle from local authorities and leaders, perhaps cross-party leaders, across the different local authority areas, please?
Thank you to Ms Dawn for her question. The only as the committee will know, is in Nottingham, and it was introduced by a Labour council and approved by a Labour government. But of course, councils in England and Wales have the power to bring in their own workplace parking levy schemes, and that is giving this legislation, rather, this SSI, gives Scottish councils the exact same power. So it's actually about giving an equivalence of power to local authorities in Scotland that they don't have with their English and Welsh counterparts, which I think is quite important. And Conservatives, of course, in the UK government have had over a decade to withdraw the power, but they haven't done so. So I think that speaks volumes to the importance of empowering local authorities, which I'm sure that every member on the committee would agree with. In terms of the COSLA position, COSLA have been very supportive of the workplace parking levy back in 2019, for example. So Councillor Heddy at the time commenting that they strongly supported the principle of the workplace parking levy as a discretionary power, whereby local authorities are granted the maximum amount of flexibility to shape a scheme that supports their wider transport and climate change strategies. And I think some of the tension that we've heard at committee this week and 2 weeks ago is around about that flexibility. I'm not here as Minister to dictate to local authorities. They have the power now, if this SSI passes today, to enact their own workplace parking levy and take forward their own schemes, their own consultation, their own impact assessments, dependent on their local area. Not for me to direct that. Now, I'll be perfectly honest, convener, there may be local authorities who say it's not for us. There may be local authorities who say, actually, this wouldn't work in our rural setting, for example. But for other local authorities, this scheme will work well. We have the Nottingham example to draw upon. It's important we do. It's the only scheme in existence in the UK at this moment in time. So therefore, it's important that government learns from that. But Ms Dawn is right to say that this has been very supported by COSLA. And also to our point around about empowering local authorities, it is, in my view, a really positive move to give local authorities another opportunity by which to raise revenue to invest in their own local transport priorities.
Thanks, Minister. Can I just ask on the last point that I made in terms of support from local authorities themselves? Have you had discussions with the local authorities themselves in Scotland?
I have not had direct discussions with local authorities on this. I think consultation with local authorities would have taken place in the 2019 Act, and potentially by my predecessor. But again, I will default to officials on the specifics of consultation with local authorities directly.
I thank the Minister for your response, and I'll pass back to the convener. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
I'm happy to come in.
Did one of the officials want to supplement the Minister's response?
Yes, it was on the point of consultation with local authorities. Convener was going to come in to confirm that we convened a working group to inform the development of the regulations, and that had local authority representation on it, including from Edinburgh and from COSLA and from Scots. So there has been local authority consultation specifically on the development of the regulation that's before the committee today. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Liam Kerr has a brief supplemental to be followed finally by Graeme Simpson. Liam, please.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, it is just a brief supplemental, Minister, because Mark Ruskell asked about modelling, and I'm not sure we got an answer involving modelling. But so I'd like to ask again, what modelling has been done by the Scottish Government on the situation where employees refuse to use the staff car park, perhaps to avoid the cost, and instead decant onto the surrounding streets? Does the modelling show that that's a possibility? To what extent, if so? And what is the impact on local residents if that happens? What does the modelling show?
So, on the specifics of decanting onto surrounding areas, this would be a matter for local authorities themselves, who have to consult in their local area and look at a range of different opportunities and impact assessment, for example, in terms of the parking availability. It's not for me to direct that, but modelling is absolutely for local authorities. Now, Mr Kerr raised this 2 weeks ago, and I gave him the detail in the letter, and I cited it again in response to him earlier on around about Nottingham. It is the only scheme, and I know Ms Lennon mentioned it as well, it is the only scheme in existence in the UK. The modelling that we have largely learnt from as a government has been based in the Nottingham example, but it is for local authorities absolutely to look at that point. We don't want, as Mr Kerr alludes to, folk, I think he said, decanting into the surrounding areas and parking in different parts to try and avoid the charge. We don't want that to happen. But we also have to trust local authorities. And my question to Mr Kerr would be, if we trust local authorities in England and Wales to do this, why are we not trusting them in Scotland? So I think it's important to have an equivalence of opportunities for local authorities across the United Kingdom. And really, we should be trusting our local authorities to do this, taking into cognizance their own local circumstances, but empowering them to raise fundamentally extra revenue, which can be invested back into the local community to the benefit of the people that they serve.
Well, that's not the question, Minister, to put to me. We're not talking about trusting local authorities. We're talking about the Scottish Government bringing in a scheme and apparently failing to model what the impact of that scheme would be. And I think you've just confirmed the modelling has not been done. Unless you are confirming that the modelling has been done at Scottish Government level, I'll hand back to Convener.
I don't agree that we have not modelled it, but we can't model something that doesn't exist.
You either have or you haven't.
But Mr Kerr, no, sorry, Convener. How can we model something that doesn't yet exist? We've got 32 different local authorities in Scotland.
You just said
it did exist. We could potentially have 32 different approaches to this. It's not for me to tell them all how to do it. This is a power for local authorities. The only way in which we can learn as a government from other parts of the United Kingdom is by looking at the Nottingham example. And I laid that out in my response to Mr Kerr previously, but additionally in the letter that I sent him. We can't model in advance of the schemes having taken place.
Can't.
We have to trust our local authority partners to do this and to get it right for their local community.
Extraordinary. Convener.
Graeme Simpson, please.
Thanks, Convener. Just one quick question and possibly a follow-up depending on the answer. I feel we've had a full debate already, but the debate is yet to come. Minister, can you confirm that in the 2019 Act, you have powers to set out further exemptions beyond what is there already. You could do that in regulations.
Yes, I will be. I'm prepared to be corrected by officials, but I think I do have those powers.
And my follow-up would be, why have you chosen not to use them and set out further exemptions?
So, to answer Mr. Simpson's question, I think I responded to Mr. Barr on this point. So the only three exemptions that exist at this moment in time are with regard to health workers, they are with regard to people visiting hospices, and those with a blue badge. They are the three national exemptions. Any other exemptions are, again, for a local authority to decide upon. It's got to be for local authorities to look at their local circumstances and decide best where those exemptions should rest. It's not for me as government minister to direct. But he is correct, convener, to say that there is provision, I think, within the legislation, although officials can come in on this if they wish to do so, for us to look again at what those national exemptions might be. At this moment in time, those are the only three that we are considering.
I'm aware of the only three, and you've just completely contradicted yourself by saying that
in
it was
respect?
Well, you said that it was up to local councils to set out
yes.
exemptions, and then you agreed with me that you could do it in regulations, which you can, but you've chosen not to.
I said there is a power, but we have not chosen to do that yet.
Okay.
So, therefore, it's for local authorities to consider it. I don't know if Mr. Simpson's suggestion is we look at further exemptions.
We'll come to that in the debate.
Okay.
Thank you.
I look forward to it.
Graham, thank you very much. That brings us to the end of questions. We now move on to the next agenda item, which is consideration of motion 03166, which is asking the committee to agree to recommend that SSI 2022-4, the Workplace Parking Licensing Scotland Regulations 2022, be annulled. I will shortly invite Graham Simpson, MSP, to speak to and move the motion that the Workplace Parking Licensing Scotland Regulations 2022 be annulled. I will then invite any committee members who wish to contribute to the debate to do so. I will then invite the Minister to respond to the debate. And finally, I will invite Graham Simpson, MSP, to wind up the debate and to press or withdraw his motion. Graham, could you please move and speak to the motion?
Thank you, convener, and I will move the motion. I will try not to take up too much of the committee's time, but the members of the committee are clearly very engaged in this. I should say that I will take any interventions that are made, including, if it's possible, from the minister. I know she's joining us remotely, but if there's a way, if she wants to intervene, and I'm able to let her, I will do that, because we need a proper debate. Now, the Minister said earlier that the reason this instrument has only just come, you know, has only just been developed and has come before Parliament was because of COVID. She said that, those were her words. And that is exactly the reason why it's wrong to bring this forward right now, because businesses are still recovering from the pandemic. The committee has heard from several organisations, the Food and Drink Federation Scotland, the Scottish Retail Consortium. We know that the Scottish Chambers of Commerce have concerns about this, as do the CBI and a number of other organisations, but businesses have made it absolutely clear that this is the wrong time to bring this forward. So, to go back to what Ms. Hislop said earlier, timing is important. It is very important. It's absolutely crucial. Businesses are struggling. They need to recover. And the last thing they need now is an extra tax. And this is an extra tax. The Minister, yes, I will.
So, can I ask, is it just the timing that you have a problem with, or are you fundamentally opposed to the scheme that was approved by the Parliament and enacted 3 years ago? And on timing, do you recognise what the Minister has said, that actually it won't be implemented by any scheme immediately? It would take time to do that, and she'd been given an indication it could be a number of years. So therefore, arguing about a position point in time as of now would actually stop local authorities doing anything for years to come. Can you respond to that, please?
I certainly will. And thank you, Ms. Hislop. On the timing matter, I do have a concern about the timing. I am fundamentally opposed to the scheme, I have to say, but I accept that there are members and there are parties in this Parliament that don't share that view, but they may share the view that the timing is wrong. So I think timing is important. Ms. Hislop and the Minister refers to the view of Glasgow City Council that any scheme could take 3 years to implement. Now, I'm not really sure what that's based on. It seemed to me to be just a figure plucked out of thin air. It clearly would take some time, but 3 years sounds like a long time to me. I haven't seen any justification for that time frame. So I think timing is important. It's very important. The Scottish Retail Consortium Director, David Lonsdale, has said workplace parking levies are a charter for extra cost and complexity. It will see firms taxed twice. This goes back to the point that I think Mr. Kerr made, for any parking places they provide for staff on top of the business rates already paid on those spaces. That is crucial because companies with car parks do pay business rates on those spaces. So this scheme would be introducing an extra layer of tax on top of what they already pay. The Scottish Chambers of Commerce have also come out in opposition. Liz Cameron, the chief executive, said that businesses across Scotland could face a postcode lottery as different councils take different decisions. And she fears that some councils may seek to implement the levy as a revenue stream rather than purely environmental reasons. Now, if we actually have a look at what's in the Parent Act, it says that councils must have a local transport strategy and the car park tax must go towards helping with that strategy. And that means it doesn't have to be about reducing motor vehicle travel. It doesn't have to be about improving public transport. It could be used for absolutely anything that's in that strategy. And so that means it's actually, or could be, a purely a money-making scheme. And that is the concern, of course, shared by Liz Cameron. It's all rather woolly. So it's not, as Mr. Ruskell would like, money could be used for improving public transport. We'd all like to see public transport improved. But that's not specifically what this levy would be for. It could be used for absolutely anything in that local transport strategy. And remember, the other point made by David Lonsdale, you know, it's a tax on top of another tax. Firms are already paying once. Why should they pay twice? Now, I raised the question 2 weeks ago about there not being a cap on what councils could charge. And the Minister gave the entirely accurate answer that there isn't one. She hasn't yet said what level she thinks would be a reasonable charge. Now, I don't know what she wants in there. She is speaking. I'm happy to let the Minister in if she wants to come in.
I'm happy to come in, but briefly, we did cover this, Mr. Simpson, 2 weeks ago. I also responded in the letter to the committee. I'm not setting a limit. It's for local authorities to decide on the limit for their local area. It's not for me to direct. This is a power for local authorities.
Okay. It would have been useful to hear from the Minister what she thinks will be an acceptable level and whether she thinks that she seems to think she has the power to call in schemes. I'll take her word for that. If she does have that power and she were to call in a scheme, what would she think would be an acceptable level per parking space? And I'll let her in again if she wants to come in.
I'm not giving Mr Simpson a number, convener. This is not for me to direct. It's for local authorities to consider. I did give the example of Nottingham, the only scheme in existence in the United Kingdom, where I think the charge is around about £2 per day. However, I'm not here to give a number because that would be me overriding local authorities and their local democratic accountability. I think that's a really important point about the regulations that we're dealing with today. This is about empowering local authorities, not about me directing them.
So far from the Minister saying that she'll be prepared to or could call in schemes and could direct them on what charges should be, she's clearly not prepared to do that. Now, she mentions Nottingham, a very, very interesting example. Nottingham is about to increase what it charges companies, and the reason for that is, and probably the Minister and Mr Ruskell certainly would rejoice at this, the money taken in by Nottingham's scheme has gone down because fewer people need parking spaces, and Mr Ruskell would think that was a good thing. But so in order to fill that gap, they are increasing the charges. So that leads you to the conclusion that in Nottingham, so lauded by some people around this table, it's actually a money-making scheme. Now, if the Minister wants to press ahead with this, she should, you know, at least fix the cap element of this instrument. She could, I'm sure she could do that. Exemptions have been mentioned, convener. The Police Federation gave some very strong comments about this. They fear, Callum Steele, their General Secretary, fears that this could be passed on to rank and file police officers. If it were not to be passed on to them, it could hit overstretched budgets for the police. Unions have come out against it. Keir Greenaway, senior organiser for GMB Scotland, said that lowest paid workers would suffer at the worst possible time with the rising cost of living. And, you know, he is absolutely right. Going back to Nottingham, a point I made 2 weeks ago, more than half of the employers in Nottingham have passed on this charge, and it is set to be nearly £500 a year per parking space onto their staff, and some of them will be low paid. So actually this is a regressive tax. So what you'll end up, Monica Lennon wants in, yes?
Thank you to Graeme Simpson. You've been very honest that, you know, in principle you're opposed to workplace parking levy, but if Parliament was to vote to annul the motion and to create a bit of space for this to be looked at again and for improvements possibly to be made, what type of things would you like the Minister to consider? Who would you like her to speak to? And what practical differences would you like to see happen? I know from our shared time in local government that you and I both want to empower local government, but we want to empower people across Scotland to be able to make the best choices for them. So, for example, would you want the Minister to look at the Everyone Aboard campaign, which wants to extend free public transport by bus to everyone under the age of 26, including people on low income and on benefits? Are these the kind of measures that you think we should be looking at as a Parliament so that perhaps there can be a place for a workplace parking levy in the future?
Yes, I'll draw my remarks to a close, convener. I know you're up against time, but Ms Lennon has asked me a direct point, which I'll try to address. I want to see public transport improved for everyone. I think that's what should come first, and that that will encourage people to use public transport and not use their cars, hopefully. So I think that's what should be coming first. My real concern about this, if we accept the parliamentary numbers appear to be that this will go through, I think what the Minister should do is try to fix the flaws in this. She should be looking at exemptions that are not there. She has the power to do that. She really ought to be setting out, probably in guidance, what she thinks an acceptable level of charge should be. Now, I don't want to see this coming in at all, but if the parliamentary numbers are what they are, Ms. Gilruth and Mr. Ruskell can get this through. If Ms. Gilruth decides to go ahead with it, then there are things she could do to improve it. She could do that. So, Convener, if I just draw my remarks to a close, I think this is the wrong time. It's an attack on employers. It's bad for employees. It's bad for jobs. It's bad for the recovery from the pandemic. It's the wrong time. It's the wrong time for businesses. It's the wrong time for staff. And it should be stopped. And I move the motion in my name. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Simpson. I now call Fiona Hislop to be followed by Liam Kerr. Fiona, please.
Thank you very much. Graeme Simpson might not be aware, but we're currently conducting in this committee an inquiry into local government and how it can work with partners to deliver net zero targets. And clearly, reduction in car use is part of tackling that. So I suppose it comes down to looking at what is facing us today in this SSI. It's not about revisiting the scheme. I think Graeme Simpson has been very upfront that he actually doesn't want a scheme at all. I think the issues that have come up are about timing, but again, the issue is are these coming in as of this year in terms of the actual charges, or is there preparation time? And also, primarily, what will the SSI do to make sure that some of the issues that have been raised today would get addressed? But they wouldn't get addressed by the Minister, they would get addressed by the local authority, and that's the choice. Do we empower local authorities or do we not? And can I be... Yes, indeed.
I'm not sure you can go of you. I do, and the Minister has confirmed that she has the power in regulations, if she chose to do it, to create further exemptions. Do you think she should do that?
I think the local authorities, in putting forward their scheme, can also use their powers that they have in the Act as well to decide what exemptions they might need. And each city might be different, for example. I do think, realistically, we're looking at the cities, we're not looking at rural areas. And I think in terms of the other aspects, in terms of a cap, well, actually, the local authorities could have that cap themselves. Indeed, they would need to do that as part of the report that they would put together in terms of their impact. Similarly, on the modelling, they would need to identify what could and couldn't be done in terms of displacement. And I don't know if other members have tried parking in Edinburgh, in the city centre of Edinburgh, for any length of time. Permits are there for local residents. They're not there for those that are seeking to come in to use their car parking space. The reality is time has changed for both our major cities in terms of their transport issues. So I think that's what it comes down to, is in terms of the ability for local authorities to make their own decisions, knowing full well, because I know from the city centre, the city leaders, that they are very involved with the local businesses about what they might need or not need. I very much welcome the funding that's been given by the Scottish Government to city centres to help in terms of the rehabilitation and recovery of city centres in our current position. So they are getting supported. But I do think in terms of looking at the scheme, Mr. Simpson referred to Nottingham. Actually, the whole point is they wanted less people to use their cars. I don't think it's surprising that there are fewer cars going into Nottingham, because that's part of what the scheme was. So I think it was a bit odd to say that was a problem for the scheme. In terms of the funding, I think it's absolutely clear that we have to have more funding in public transport. Yes, we need more national funding, and others may want to see what efforts they made in terms of the budget that we've just gone through in terms of transportation increases. But again, that can be used locally. And I do think that impact consultation and the report that local authorities will have to, by this SSI produce, will address a lot of the concerns that have been raised. And finally, and I think this is a debate, so I think it's worth commenting on the Conservatives' 2021 Scottish Parliament manifesto, when they said that councils should lead post-COVID reviews of changed travel patterns in their area and be encouraged to create more low-traffic neighbourhoods, bus and bike only roads, school streets and local emission zones where they would be beneficial. And finally, because I think this is the nub of the matter, do we trust local authorities or do we not? And Mr. Simpson back in the 2017 local government manifesto for the Conservatives said, we need to empower councils and give them a renewed sense of meaning and purpose. They can and must be the engines of growth. We believe that decisions should be taken as locally as possible and that power should lie with politicians elected as locally as possible. So I think this SSI comes down, do we trust local authorities to make their decisions? I do not expect every local authority to be implementing this. I think it's clear that the two major cities are interested in this, but even before they get to implement this, they have to produce a report, they have to do an impact assessment, and any time they or indeed the Minister can appoint a reporter to examine those propositions. And on that, convener, I think I will end, but I thank everyone for giving an hearing to what is a very important subject. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Fiona, Liam Kerr to be followed by Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, convener. 2 years ago, the Parliament passed the Transport Bill, which contained the ability to levy a car park tax. Now, I and my colleagues tried to amend that to make it what we saw as more equitable, to exempt people like the police, care workers, shift workers, and to ensure those not living or working close to public transport wouldn't be caught. Now, as Graham Simpson rightly pointed out, the then government wasn't with us on either those amendments or the final form of the bill, and it passed. And we're now presented with these regulations and Mr Simpson's motion to annul. Now, I've listened very carefully to the evidence given by the Transport Minister to this committee recently. I've read her letter to us last week. I've listened to her answers this morning. The thing that comes out for me on this is the lack of detail that is still persisting in this scheme to the potential detriment of so many people. And I find that particularly concerning, given that, as I mentioned earlier, Transport Scotland specifically acknowledged the requirement for guidance only 5 months ago, guidance which the Minister acknowledges doesn't exist. And we've heard previously that there's no cap on what might be charged, and nothing would prevent employers passing the cost on to employees. And indeed, the evidence we've received in this committee suggests that they will. And the government wants to drive behaviour change, but it couldn't give me a figure as to what they think might achieve that behaviour change. And I listened to the response by the Minister to Mr Simpson's remarks. The Minister can call in an unreasonable charge, but has no idea or is not prepared to set out what she believes is an unreasonable charge. What is the definition of that? So we also heard that no modelling has been done on the impact of decanting onto surrounding streets, nor on the impact, as my friend Ms Lennon pointed out, on lower paid workers. There have been no clear answers as to how the funds generated will benefit rural areas and or those areas in which people paying live but do not work, so those councils of those commuting from a rural town into a city, for example. And it appears no one has checked whether it is competent, legally competent, to tax the same piece of land twice under two separate heads. Now, these regulations do not address these significant concerns, nor many of the others that we've heard today. And the lack of progress on addressing these issues is highly concerning. Fiona Hislop rightly makes the point about timing. Now, I have no doubt that doing this work was going to be challenging during the pandemic, but that is why I cannot understand the urgency of forcing what appears to me an undercooked, underprepared scheme through in such a hurry. This committee's heard about the DRS scheme at some length, and that, of course, has been significantly delayed due to the lack of detail, the lack of rigour underlying it. Now, some of this committee will welcome, as Graham Simpson said, the car park tax, but no one welcomes bad legislation. And I say to the committee to heed the convener's question right at the start, which I'm afraid I didn't hear a proper answer to. What happens if we vote today for the motion to annul? I think voting for the motion to annul today allows the minister to take this project away and have a rethink, address the significant concerns that she's heard about, find answers to the questions the committee has posed, and come back with a scheme that actually works, doesn't risk destroying businesses, and doesn't penalise the lowest paid workers. My view, convener, is let's get it right rather than getting it rushed. And these are the reasons, convener, that I shall vote for the motion to annul this morning.
Thank you very much, Liam. Jackie Dunbar to be followed by Monica Lennon. Jackie, over to you, please.
Thank you, convener. I wasn't here 2 years ago when the Act was passed. I was and still am a serving councillor at Aberdeen City Council. And can I just say how exciting it is that local authorities are going to be empowered with more decision making. I think it's something that everybody cross-party, I would say, has been welcoming for years. So it's disappointing today to hear, well, and that's what I'm hearing anyway, that some people think that maybe local government shouldn't have the empowerment to make the choices that affects those within their local communities. We've heard a lot today, and I'll thank the Minister for answering my questions on exemptions, because that was something that I was very keen to hear. And what I heard today was the exemptions would be a case-by-case situation, and for me that even breaks it down into local authorities. If there is an exemption case brought forward in my constituency of Aberdeen Donside, it might not be appropriate to have that exemption in Aberdeen Central or Aberdeen South, because there is different areas within even the local authorities where I think...
intervention.
Yes, of course.
Thank Jackie Dunbar for taking the intervention. You focused a lot on exemptions. We've established that the Minister could make exemptions on a national level. For example, teachers, police officers who often have to park outside, who do have to park outside their work. Is that the sort of thing that you would like to see?
Sorry, would you like the Minister to make that decision? Is that
would
what
you like the Minister to make that sort of move?
I think it's up to the local authorities to make that decision, and I'm still a serving councillor to me, so I'm still going to say that. I mean, you said about the police in my patch, well, in my ward as well as my constituency, we've got a police station in Maastricht who doesn't have a car parking place. They park with in the roundabout about area. So to say that the police or teachers or whatever, you know, would be pushed out isn't necessarily the case. And I think that, again, that it is down to local authorities to make those decisions. They are the ones that should be empowered to make the decision of, is it appropriate for their area? What would be the impact would be? I mean, and the Minister said in her question in answering that Nottingham has exempted 10 parking spaces or less. Our local authorities would have that ability to choose. So that would protect the small businesses. Our councillors are very good at listening to the local communities. They are the coalface of politics, and they're the ones that hear when things are right or when things are being done wrong. So I have every single faith in them moving forward to be able to make those decisions. I won't be a serving councillor by the time this comes in, but I do think it is the right thing to do. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jackie. Next up, Monica Lennon, to be followed by Mark Ruskell.
Thank you, convener. I think we have to have this discussion in the context of the pandemic and COVID recovery, the cost of living crisis, and I think just to show that Parliament and Government are listening to the people who will be directly affected. And for me, the starting point is the workers that this levy is aimed at. You know, we don't know how many workers would pick up the cost of this, but we can see that the business is also very concerned. So I think, you know, Graeme Simpson has been very honest that he is opposed to it no matter what. I would like to get to a place where I could support a workplace parking levy in the future, but I agree with the points made that we have to demonstrate that public transport is affordable, is accessible, and is safe for everyone who needs to use it. So I am concerned that these discussions have not been taking place in recent weeks with the STUC and workers on the front line. I don't agree that this decision today is a judgment on the ability of local government to make good choices for local communities. But I do think we should be trying to take action as Parliament. It doesn't exacerbate inequality. So I do believe that we should have a rights-based approach. And I think that the points that have been raised about exemptions, you know, it would be unfair if police officers in Glasgow were exempt but not exempt in Edinburgh. So I think there should be some basic things that we get right at a national level. And I do wonder if that's an issue that the government should reflect on in terms of guidance that could be set nationally so that we get some broad principles agreed. And that would help local government if in future they were thinking about delivering a scheme. I have some trouble with the discussion around modelling. My understanding is that modelling is about looking at events that maybe haven't happened yet and trying to look at different scenarios. So for me, the modelling should have been done by the Scottish Government, that would have looked at a number of things that relate to the Scottish context in terms of the policies we have already, the infrastructure we have right now, and to try and model the behaviour change in Scotland. I think we're focusing too heavily on the Nottingham experience, and Nottingham's a city that I know very well through family connections, but I would have liked to have heard more about what analysis has been done to look at possible scenarios in Scotland. I think we do have to recognise that bus and train fares are rising. Cycling infrastructure is not good enough. People don't feel safe walking the streets to their work, particularly women. We've got the National Union of Students arriving in, I think, 50 minutes' time to do a protest at Parliament about the poverty that students are facing, and they've also raised concerns about the workplace parking levy. So I think it would be remiss of us as legislators, as parliamentarians, to turn our face against these concerns and say, well, this legislation was passed a couple of years ago. We have to take responsibility now. So I do agree with the motion that we should annul this and use this time to try and get this right, because all the discussions that we've had around climate emergency and COP26 and what happens next is that people do want a just transition, and they want to see bold action, but they don't want to see those who have the least and who have done the least to cause climate change bear the burden. And one of the things that sticks out in my mind that came up during COP26 is that the government-owned Prestwick Airport, people can fly in on their private jets for business meetings and park for free, but we're potentially asking low-wage workers, people on minimum wage, on zero-hour contracts, to pay this, and we can't give them straight answers. So these are some of the inequalities that I would like to see addressed. So I will be supporting the motion to annul today.
Okay, thank you very much, Monica. Mark Ruskell next, to be followed by Natalie Dawn.
Yeah, thanks, convener. I really fear that this debate this morning has been a complete waste of time. I totally respect the fact that Graeme Simpson has got an ideological opposition to workplace parking levy. He's entitled to have that. He's entitled to challenge the provision of workplace parking levy in the 2019 Transport Act. I can't remember if he did it at the time, but the Tories certainly tried to get it struck down. But we're beyond that now, and the motion that he moves today won't remove that provision from the statute book. If he wants to remove it from the statute book, he's more than welcome to bring forward a member's bill, make this a defining campaign of this session of Parliament. But, his motion to annul will not do that. And I think it's telling that at the UK government level, a similar provision remains in UK law. Some councils have made use of that. Other councils have decided not to. That's been their decision. But there's been no attempt by the UK government to remove this provision. if that's something Mr. Simpson wants to try and do, then he's more than welcome to do that. But that's not the effect of what he's moving today. It might be his intention, but it's not the effect. Now, look, I know that post-2019, there was a detailed discussion in virtually all local authorities across Scotland about whether they wanted to introduce workplace parking levies or not. And I can remember discussing local authorities in my own region. Some of those that were more rural in nature decided not to introduce this. They had that discussion locally with businesses and with major employers around their towns and cities and decided that either the time wasn't right then or it wasn't a provision that they were wanting to pursue. And I think, you know, we need to trust local authorities. We need to empower local authorities. As a key point made by Jackie Dunbar, we need to ensure that that discussion happens locally. And the decision to push forward a workplace parking levy or not is taken at that local level. Now, you know, since 2019, what has changed? Well,
Mr. Ruskell,
you know, we've got a climate emergency. Yeah, briefly.
Yeah, I'm very grateful, particularly given the circumstances. It's just, as you're speaking, I'm listening very carefully to what you're saying, Mr. Ruskell, and you asked the Minister what I thought was a very good question about the modelling that had been done about whether businesses would come back to town and city centres. And we didn't get an answer on the modelling. We got an aspiration. You got an aspiration, but not an answer on whether the modelling had been done. Now, you've listened to the session this morning. There have been lots of requests about what modelling, what data is being relied upon here, and that is lacking. Surely, Mr. Ruskell, you accept that data is lacking, and it would be better to go back, work out what that looks like, work out the impact on lower paid workers, work out the impact on the rural communities, and then come back at a later date once those have been corrected.
Well, I think, Mr. Kerr, you're getting hung up on the word modelling. This isn't a simple input-output spreadsheet where you put the cost of workplace parking levy in and you get some kind of output from that. What all councils need to do is look at the experience of where workplace parking levies have been introduced and have those detailed discussions with employers that operate within their areas, with communities, around how a scheme might work. It's only through doing that work can you then get an understanding about what the aspirations of employers might be, whether they may wish to move back to city centre locations that would benefit the local economy and may well have lower numbers of parking spaces. But that's a conversation with the individual employers. You're not going to, you know, put all that data into a spreadsheet, Mr. Kerr, and suddenly get an answer. It requires that discussion, that local democratic process to work out how a workplace parking levy could be introduced. But I think we've got good evidence coming from where it's been introduced in England. And I think the quicker that we can get on with introducing WPO in Edinburgh and Glasgow, we'll then have a solid base of evidence to then empower other local authorities and make a decision about whether it's the right thing for them to do. We only really get to the end point of this by learning through doing and by actually implementing workplace parking levy on the ground. But look, I'll come back to what has changed since 2019. The climate emergency has accelerated, and we all know in this committee how hard it is to bring down those transport emissions. You know, the low-hanging fruit is gone. We have to make decisions here, and this Parliament did make a decision in 2019 to put this in as an option for local authorities to deliver. We also know that congestion is not coming down in our cities. And that's you're damaging not just our health, but it's damaging our economy as well. You know, £7 billion was lost to the UK economy last year through congestion. That's not benefiting anybody. That's not benefiting the businesses that have concerns about workplace parking levy. That's not benefiting any part of our economy or society. Monica Lennon talks about the decline of bus services, and this is an area that, you know, we share some concerns. But, you know, I do see this as a way of investing additional resources, additional funding to actually give everybody a much better alternative to the car. And that needs work. You know, the existing programs that local councils have will not be enough to meet the 20% vehicle reduction mileage target.
Will Matt Ruskell give way on that point?
And to ensure... if I've got time, convener.
Sure.
Thank you to Mark Wiscoe. To go back to the example of the X1 bus, which was an express service between Hamilton and Glasgow, well used in the local area, but First, who didn't share their modelling and their data, said it wasn't making enough profit. Now, there's been a lot of sympathy across the political spectrum. The community's fought really hard, but that bus route hasn't been returned. And constituents of mine now say, not all of them, but many of them say they now drive or car share to get to work in the city. Is there anything in this workplace parking levy that is going to make it possible for that bus to come back? Because this is not a theoretical debate. People are having to make these choices when they get up in the morning and when they're coming home from work. And sadly, in that case I'm giving you, people who were using the bus on a regular basis are now using the car. And is this workplace parking levy going to change that situation?
I think it can, and I share your concerns. I mean, I had a similar issue with the X53, which I brought to a members' debate in Parliament, and there has been a lack of transparency from the companies about why they're pulling certain services. I know COVID has had an impact on that as well. But look, I think this comes down to the imagination of councils to devise local transport strategies that put in place robust local bus partnerships that ensure that we can make services viable going forward. And that could include, you know, municipal bus companies. I don't see why, if that's part of a local transport strategy under the provisions of this legislation, why we can't see additional investment, and I stress the additional investment in those kind of initiatives. I think it's for us to really push the boundaries out about how WPL can be used to really incentivise those public transport services and ensure that they're in place as WPO is actually being rolled out. So I think the case now, particularly given the cost of living crisis, is stronger to bring in a measure that can drive this investment and give ordinary families the public transport systems that they deserve and that they need. And, you know, I take objection to what, you know, Mr. Simpson's saying. This isn't a, you know, I don't think you're going to see councils coming forward and spending workplace parking levy on building motorways. That's not what it's for. It's an anti-congestion measure. It's a measure to invest in the alternatives, to actually give people the alternatives that they desperately need. It would just be bizarre for councils.
I need to make a bit of
I think I need to make a bit of progress now, Mr. Simpson.
Oh, come on.
So, you know, the purpose of the local transport strategies, which will have to link into the national transport strategies, will be to drive down congestion to meet that 20% vehicle mileage reduction target. So the investments that come from that WPO will be used to fund, have to be able to meet that target, have to be able to work with that direction of travel. So it's not a money-making scheme. It's a tram building scheme, Mr. Simpson. It's a cycle lane building scheme. It's a bus priority scheme building scheme. That's what WPL is for. It is about investing in the future. And I think it's high time we just got on and delivered it. Right, back to you, convener.
Thank you very much, Mark. Natalie Dawn next, to be followed by the Minister. Natalie, over to you, please.
Thanks, convener. Yeah, I think while we've heard legitimate concerns this morning around this proposal, there are legitimate answers to these as well, which we likewise have heard here today. And I don't think that we should delay this any further. There seems to have been a lot of emphasis this morning on the charge cap and examples of really, really extreme circumstances relating to the implementation of this levy. And I've lost count of the number of times, actually, that the point has been made that it will be for local authorities to decide what happens in their areas. Those opposed seem to have really, it's been touched on by my colleague Jackie and Mark, but very, very little faith in the ability of local councils to implement this in a way that works for their area. And as a councillor myself, I find that shocking, because we are best placed to know what's going on in our local areas and what would work. And given the consultation and the regulations that have to be carried out in line with this, that just backs that up even more, backs up the local authority to be the best place to take this forward. I don't understand the thinking why local authorities in Scotland should not have the same powers as those in England. And we've seen that it's been effectively utilised in England and Wales. And as I've kind of touched on, this is not just going to happen overnight. We've heard that this is going to take years. There's things in place so that local authorities have to go through a due process and consultations to find the best way that works for them at the end. Achieving our 2030 target of 75% emissions is going to require significant changes to behaviour, and this is a tool for local authorities to support this. And I'm absolutely behind that. I think it's extremely positive that the revenue that's going to be raised by these levies will be used to support the objectives of local transport strategies. And I completely understand the sentiments that have been raised around the cost of living crisis we're experiencing just now, but transport improvements that could come about through this could be hugely beneficial to people in poverty or to those on low incomes who are disproportionately affected just now by poor public transport services. And again, it will be for councils to read what's best in their area. So I concur with Mr Simpson's comments in 2017, which we have already heard today, in regards to empowering local councils and taking decisions locally. So I'm wondering what has changed. To me, it appears this morning there's been more interest in playing party politics than empowering local communities to actually follow this through and tackling climate change. So in conclusion, convener, I think that this will be hugely beneficial for some areas, and where it won't be, councils who know their area best will have the option to implement this or not. They'll be able to shape the scheme, provide exemptions, as we've heard, and set fees. And again, if it's not right for their area, they'll be able to decide that. We talk about localism. We talk about handing more power to local authorities. So I think we should continue with this, and I'll be voting against this motion to annul. Thanks, convener.
Thank you, Natalie. I will now pass over to the minister to respond to the points raised.
Convener, thank you. Having listened to the points raised in the debate, I do come back to the point that most of these issues have been decided by Parliament in the 2019 Transport Act some 3 years ago, or they relate to the details of specific schemes which are for local authorities' discretion, empowerment and local accountability as part of the requirement in the Act to set out schemes, results and carry out impact assessments. Now, there was a conversation around about the regulations looking at introducing a cap, for example, on charges. If the motion today goes forward and is annulled, I can't change it. It has to be done by primary legislation. So I think members need to understand that. We've had a conversation around about that today, but we need to be very clear about what we're voting on today. These are the regulations. I cannot unpick the regulations to introduce a cap. It would have to be done via primary legislation. But what the regulations do is they give local authorities the powers that they have already been provided with in the Act. And that's hugely important. Now, we've heard from members in summing up contributions and also in the question and answer session, this power already exists in England and Wales, where we have a Labour administration in Nottingham and a Conservative government who have been perfectly happy for these powers to exist and to operate. And likewise, we've heard that certain local authorities in England and Wales don't choose to use this power. But that's in the gift of local authorities. It's not for politicians like me or ministers to direct. These powers were given by the Parliament on the basis that local authorities can design schemes that reflect their local circumstances. There are robust requirements on local authorities to consult the people who are likely to be impacted by local schemes, and requirements for local authorities to undertake impact assessments. But fundamentally, these powers are about trusting our local authorities.
Will the minister take an intervention?
Absolutely.
Can I thank the minister for taking the intervention? Minister, you said in your opening comments that the reason this instrument had been delayed was because of COVID. Mm. Businesses are still struggling, a point I made earlier. Why do you think now is the right time to introduce this instrument?
So, on Mr. Simpson's first point, I want to make it very clear that the delay related to resource in government, because we had to redirect vast ways of civil servants to deal with the emergency legislation we had to pass back in 2020, he will recall, not because it was a bad idea. And on this point about businesses and what's the right time, in my previous role, Mr. Simpson will recall, of course, the UK government took a decision not to extend the transition period during the worst excesses of the pandemic, and instead to plough ahead with a hard Brexit impacting, devastating many businesses across Scotland. So I find it quite difficult to take lessons from the Conservatives on what's the right time to take forward legislation like this, which will impact on businesses. I also think that to some extent the Conservatives have used COVID to hide behind some of the impacts of Brexit. I hope very much there's not a suggestion here from the Conservatives that COVID can be used to hide behind the climate emergency. We heard from Mr. Ruskell the need for urgency on this. We have to get on, and the workplace parking levy is one such way in which we can work with local authorities to achieve our climate change ambitions.
We take another intervention.
The only concerns.
We take another
intervention. I'd like to make some progress. I'd like to make some progress, Mr. Simpson. On the concerns raised today about impacts on different types of businesses and workers, those points, of course, will be for local authorities to consider, to consult on and to assess. The Act gives local authorities the power to shape their own schemes by specifying the time of day, for example. I think that's actually quite important. Now, Monica Lennon talked about vulnerable workers. I think that's important. We look at the time of day, what type of workers are working at which time of day, for example, women working in nighttime industries, potentially in hospitality, geographic boundary and local exemptions to ensure that councils have the flexibility and discretion to support positive outcomes. And as we heard, I think, 2 weeks ago in my response to Ms. Hislop, two or more local authorities might want to work together to create their own scheme. We've kind of skirted around the edges of the climate change emergency today, but I do want to come back to this because...
Would you take an intervention, Minister, just briefly?
Yes, Mr. Kerr.
I'm very grateful. Just, I want to go back to that question earlier on because obviously, and I understand why, but you're pushing a lot of this onto local authorities. Now, Transport Scotland said supporting regulations and guidance will be necessary to provide national consistency on key elements of the scheme. You told me earlier that this hasn't even been started, I think. When can the local authorities expect that guidance to be finalised and produced?
I don't think I said to you, Mr. Kerr, that it has not been started. I don't think that's accurate. We plan to publish guidance in the first half of 2022 if Parliament agrees to the regulations today. And in our guidance for local authorities, we will outline the themes that emerge from the public consultation, which of course was undertaken to inform the regulations and guidance. This will include issues that were outwith the scope of these regulations, but that local authorities might want to look at in their own consultations. And that guidance will also include referencing to the support already available to local authorities in existing guidance for best practice in terms of their own consultations. Now, I mentioned the climate change emergency before taking the intervention from Mr. Kerr, and I think it's important we link back to that, because all parties in this chamber supported the ambitious, legally binding emissions reductions targets in the Scottish Climate Change Act. And workplace parking licensing schemes have the potential to encourage the use of more sustainable travel while also raising revenue that will be used to improve public and sustainable transport. And I think that was a key point made by Mark Ruskell. Now is the time to support the Climate Change Act with real actions, not just words. Now, we've heard much today from the Nottingham example. I again, convener, make the point that this is the only scheme in operation in the United Kingdom. And I would point to the positive outcomes that have been outlined in previous evidence given by Nottingham City Council, a Labour-run council, to the predecessor committee to this one. Nottingham, of course, has among the highest public transport use in the country, with an associated fall of 40 million car miles over the last 15 years. And the revenue from the workplace parking levy has also supported the expansion of Nottingham's successful tram system, which I mentioned earlier. Nottingham's also made grants available to support employers to implement sustainable transport measures such as cycle parking, for example. Again, a hugely significant investment. Convener, in conclusion, I am pleased that this government has brought forward these regulations so that local authorities in Scotland can make use of the new discretionary powers that Parliament provided to them. I do not support the motion to annul these regulations, which are technical and necessary in order for workplace parking licensing schemes to be implemented in an effective and a transparent manner. And I would urge Mr. Simpson to withdraw his motion, and if he does not so, do so for members of this committee to oppose the motion to annul the regulations today. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. I now invite Graeme Simpson, MSP, to wind up the debate.
Thank you very much, Convener. It's been a very full debate, so I do not intend to delay the committee for very much longer. I would simply make a couple of points, and nobody's really addressed this point. The Minister didn't address it when I intervened on her. She instead wanted to talk about Brexit. This is not the right time to introduce this instrument. Companies, employers are suffering at the moment. We need to be building back from the pandemic. The wrong way to do that is to impose extra taxes on employers, which could potentially be passed on to employees. That could well happen. On the matter of exemptions, which has been raised, the Minister does have the power to introduce exemptions. She seems not to want to use it. But that would cover people like shift workers, for example. I used to be a shift worker myself and had to work in a city centre. It was a concern, particularly for some of my female colleagues, having to walk through a city centre late at night. But what if you work in an industrial estate at night where there is no public transport and your employer decides to pass on this parking levy to their staff, which they could well do? I will give way.
I think the member is addressing one of the key points of exemptions which local authorities could make themselves, and indeed for those that have got very big tourism hospitality interests. So cities like Edinburgh might want to consider that. There are very few industrial plants in the very centres of cities, for example, but I think his point about shift workers is well made. But he seems to be saying that the minister needs to make that decision. Why does he not think that local authorities, and particularly the cities that are seriously looking at this, have got the capability of understanding either shift working or indeed where the industrial estates are within their city centre boundaries? Why does he not trust them?
It's not a matter of not trusting local councils, Ms Hislop. You helpfully mentioned our previous local government manifesto, which I was the author of, and so I agree with every word of it. And we'll wait and see what transpires for the next one. It's not a matter of not trusting local councils, but the minister has the power to introduce exemptions. She could set that out, and I think, and actually this is a point that I made during the process of the Act. I tried to get it into the Act that we would exempt shift workers, we would exempt people who either don't live near to public transport or don't work near to public transport. Unfortunately, I was unsuccessful, but it is a real, real concern if this goes through. Convener, I'm going to end it there because I think we've spent probably long enough. We've explored all the issues, but I will move the motion to annul.
Thank you very much, Mr Simpson. And that brings us to motion 03166 in the name of Graham Simpson, MSP. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. As we are in hybrid meeting, we will have a roll call vote, and I will invite members to vote in alphabetical order, with my vote being cast at the end. The choices are yes, no, or abstain to the motion. First up is Natalie Dawn. How do you vote, Natalie?
No.
Jackie Dunbar?
No.
Fiona Hislop?
No.
Liam Kerr?
Yes.
Monica Lennon?
Yes.
Mark Ruskell?
No.
And my vote is yes. All members have now voted. The results of the vote are 3 in favour, 4 against, and 0 abstentions. The motion is therefore disagreed. The committee will now produce a report on this draft instrument reflecting the evidence and the votes cast. Is the committee content to delegate responsibility to me as convener to agree this report on behalf of the committee? Yes. Thank you very much. That brings us to the end of this session. I would like to thank the minister and her officials for their time this morning. Thank you very much. And that brings us to the end of the public session. Thank you. From the clerk is that item 4 I mentioned at the beginning of the committee meeting will be deferred to next week because of timing considerations. Thank you very much.